Soloists this day, and it's wonderful to see them. We've got a lot of neat stuff going on. We are honoring, along with receiving new members joining our church today, we're honoring our longest term member, Robbie Krug, as well. We'll come to that later in the service. I don't think Robbie knows we're doing that today. We got her here under false pretenses. Now, Robbie, I can truly say you are not our oldest member, but you are our longest term member for sure. We'll talk more about Robbie a little bit later in the service too, and then the church has made a special extended special honor for her. We'll talk about it as well at the end of the service. Several announcements as we gather today that I'll put my glasses on for. Oh yeah, I didn't need glasses for this. I'm out of town next week. So, if you have a pastoral emergency during that time, Jeannie, they can call you at what number?
3198.
extension 3198. And as always, you can always leave a message for either Jeannie or myself. We do receive email notification of those messages and can hear them. I will not necessarily be checking messages a lot next week, so feel free to leave a message for Jeannie if you have a pastoral email next week. We have so there will be no Bible study on Thursday as well, just as a heads up on that. We have a special guest preacher next Sunday. A few of you have met Laren Jackson before. Laren is an American Baptist preacher and a former Denver Bronco. He would also want me to say very quietly, also a former Atlanta Falcon. But wonderful guy, and he will be bringing the message next week. Encourage you to come, invite a friend. He's a wonderful preacher, great guy, and he'll have a chance during talkback to talk a little bit about not only his sermon, but he's got a wonderful ministry to at-risk youth here in Denver. So he can help talk about that as well, I hope, during talkback. We have a brunch today as well. See, we can't just receive members. We can't just honor Robbie Krug. We've got to eat, too. And the good thing is this is the first church-wide fellowship brunch we've had since we've returned to worship. So special thing to join us. I hope you will indeed join us after the service. We'll gather and we will enjoy some food and fellowship together as well. As we come together in worship, I invite you to hear these words from Psalm 106 as we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. Save us, O Lord our God, and gather us from among the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name and glory in your praise. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting, and let all the people say amen. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, as we gather in this place, surrounded by the love and the warmth of our brothers and sisters in Christ, we pray truly that our worship would be pleasing and acceptable to you. May the words we speak, the songs we sing, the prayers we offer, be pleasing in your sight, O God. We ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Street. I'd invite you now as we gather together in our time of worship to come together. Let's join together in our song call to worship. The words are on the screen, on the front page of your bulletin as well. Let's remain seated and sing together the first verse of Morning Has Broken. Singing the refrain. We'll actually start with the refrain, and David Heck will lead us we'll sing the verses as solo, and we'll then rejoin him on the refrain. The words are on the screen as well as in the insert in your bulletin. Let's remain seated together and sing Lord God Almighty.
Worship. morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Please join me in the responsive words of praise. Our hearts are full of praise, O God.
Because of your wonderful works.
You are the Almighty, the King of creation.
And you rule over all with mercy and justice.
You prosper and sustain us.
So that we might serve you in your kingdom, now and forever.
Hear our praise this day, O God.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is such a joy to be here, to share worship, to share God's love, and to remember how much He loves us. And Jesus' commandments to love one another. And I think the best way for us to obey that commandment is to pray for each other, to pray for those we don't even know. And in our community, we have a couple of people in the hospital, Stella Martinez and Shelly Sherry Preston. And Jim did talk to Stella this week and felt she was doing pretty well. I spoke with Sherry this morning, and she is so appreciative of the prayers we have for her and hope they'll continue. We also pray for Alberta Forster, Bill Hale, Karen Jacobs, Dorothy Tweedell, and Jan Whitfield. Becky Conger asked for prayers for her sister Debbie.
She is recovering
now. Oh, that's great news. Really good news. Tell her we're pleased.
Thank you.
Carol Dane asked for prayers for a family member with serious health concerns. Lisa Haskinson asked for prayers for her brother, Scott. Rod asked for prayers for his friend, Gary. And Ronnie Zeiss, I always say that wrong. For her granddaughter, Freedom, who finally had that baby. That's exciting, and the baby's doing well. Her name is Harley. And a joy, a celebration for Robbie and her family was the wedding of her grandson Taylor yesterday and his new wife Diana. Pass on our prayers to them as well. We pray for Dee's family, Dewilla Dameron. And Les and Ruth asked for prayers for their friend Beth, as well as Les's brother and sister-in-law. Are there any additions? You know the prayer list is updated on that bulletin board out there in the hallway twice a week, I hope. Any additions? We also pray for our world. COVID has created an amazing situation all around the world. In fact, we are the most fortunate, I think. But we pray for all who are suffering and afflicted from COVID. We pray for everyone who is experiencing hurricanes. Oh my goodness, it's an especially difficult season. We also pray for those who are suffering with political unrest. But most of all, we pray that we all have love and mercy for each other, excluding no one, absolutely no one. As we prepare for our time of silent prayer, we'll sing Alleluia. Please pray with me. Our Heavenly Father, this morning we humbly gather before you in awe of your grace and your love for us. Because of that love and grace, we trust you with our lives and the lives of our loved ones, also the well-being of our country and of our world. We come not as strangers, but we come as your children. Help us spend less energy in our attempt to be in control, realizing you need us to trust you, to let go, to take time to talk to you in prayer. Give us ears to hear your promptings, to intercede, or perhaps to just listen to your advice. And then teach us to obey. We ask your presence for those in our hearts who are in need of healing of many kinds. We pray for our community, our nation, and our world, that your love and peace will bring a better life for all. On this day, as we acknowledge our fears for our world, we pray for the safety of those affected by weather, violence, war, and illness. We pray that any of our own differences will not get in the way of peace. Often just hearing of these difficulties is very upsetting. Please remind us of your unconditional love for each person on this earth. When it seems there's no hope, we must stop and ask for your guidance, your assurance. We must flip the switch and allow your many blessings to enter our thoughts and actions. We thank you for generous housing and food, abundant and clean water, loving family and friends. Our place here at the foot of the beautiful Rocky Mountains is always inspirational, and we have so many days of sunshine. Help us to trust you with these worldly concerns, and then lead us to be grateful, truly acknowledging with joy the love and blessings you offer every moment of our day. As we leave the sanctuary of this place renewed, take us into our worlds, loving others as you love, especially the unlovable. We continue to love in awe with the prayer that you taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Doxology as the ushers bring our donations, our contributions, our gifts forward. But you know what? I learned a few years ago that it's more than that. It's more than our financial contributions. I was so blessed to take a trip to Alaska with my sister and a couple of friends. Oh my goodness, what beauty. It's indescribable. It's so beautiful. And we long waited toward the end of our trip to see the glaciers. Holy smokes, they're great. They're white, they're noisy, they're huge, and there's even more under the water. We were so lucky that the ship decided to stay there for a couple of hours so we really could watch. And then the ship turned, and one of my friends said, let's go to the back so we can see them until we can't see them. And as we stood there, she began to sing, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. I hope you think about those words when we sing again today. Will the ushers come forward?
I invite you now to please stand as we sing together our doxology. You'll find the words in your memories. Inserts in your bulletin. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. And we will do verses 1 and 4 today. Let's remain seated and sing together verses 1 and 4 of 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. People plan and God laughs. It's kind of been this morning. It started very early. I won't go into details. But you know, tomorrow's kind of a special day for Jeannie and I. It's payday. Yeah. Isn't that exciting? And you know, Jeannie's kind of an old-fashioned gal. She likes things the way they used to be, more. So I have made some special arrangements with our payroll department for Jeannie's payroll this morning. Ridiculous to pay Jeannie in salt, but if we're going to go back to the old days, not at all. You see, when Jesus is talking about salt, it's something so different from what we think of. And salt back in those days, and in the days leading up to his lifetime, was a very valuable commodity. As a matter of fact, if I were to use the phrase, Jeannie is worth her salt, that's where that comes from. And even the word soldier is taken from the word saltier, one who is paid in salt. Now, by Jesus' day, truly the Roman Empire had kind of developed coinage. They had most of the business and government functions transacted using coins. You know, those ones with Caesar's picture on them that we hear a little bit about later. But the truth is, salt was very valuable. Different than what we think about it. If any of you have ever seen me eating, you might know I've got a special relationship with salt. My doctor would go so far as to recently say a little too special. We think of salt as a spice, a flavoring ingredient, something to make the food taste better. But in Jesus' day, in those old times, that was not the case. See, that was the day before refrigeration, before chemical food preservatives. And the only way to really preserve food was with salt. They discovered that salt has antibiotic properties, it draws moisture out, and so the farmers figured out they could pack beef, meat, and salt. They could salt vegetables, and all of a sudden those could travel and be sold further distances. It's a revolutionary world, a revolution to the world. As a matter of fact, there are historians who like to point out that world history, the whole course of world history, changed because of this discovery of how salt could be used. And other historians point to the Roman Empire and said, you know, the only reason they really became kind of like an octopus spreading their tentacles out all over that Mediterranean region was for salt. There's an old saying, if the salt is flowing in Rome, the emperor stays. And they made sure that that happened. They conquered territories as far as away as Israel. They built magnificent roads, and so much of it was because of trade, but especially because of salt. But salt in our world is a little different, isn't it? It's just a spice. It's an additive. We have huge mechanized salt mines. I don't know if any of you have been out in Utah by Salt Lake. There's an incredible mechanized salt plant there. And today, on seacoasts around the world, there are water desalinization plants. They take the seawater and they turn it into fresh water for irrigating crops, and the byproduct is tons of salt that end up in jars like this that I think cost me $1. But in those days, several hundred dollars worth of salt right there. So congratulations on your payday, Jeannie.
No,
it's enough, Jeannie. It's adequate. So Jesus tells his disciples, by the way, this passage that Lynn read for us today comes from the Sermon on the Mount, where he's telling those who would follow him what their life, what their world is supposed to be like. And in the middle of it, he kind of interrupts himself with this tale of salt and light. So what does he mean? Well, we're not called to be just flavoring for the world. I think sometimes Christians get that idea that we're just supposed to be an obnoxious voice that people need to know is here, but this is much more than that. We're to be a preservative to a world that is just decaying. So how do we do that? We're going to come back to that. It's not an easy story. But we are called to preserve, to protect the world. And by the world, of course, Jesus means all of God's children. Back in 1995 in Billings, Montana, hate was really consuming the city. A synagogue was vandalized. An African-American church was vandalized. The homes of Native American residents were vandalized, Hispanic residents. Graffiti, anti-racist graffiti painted all over. And then one evening in 1995, a neighborhood was awoken by the shattering of glass. It turns out a brick had been thrown through the window of a 6-year-old Jewish boy who had put his menorah in the window. That was enough to not only wake up the neighbors, but to wake up the neighbors. Next door to that family was a family whose father was the pastor at the local Methodist church down the street, and his son's best friend was that little boy. He said, "This cannot be." And so with his church's approval, they put menorahs and images of menorahs on all the church windows, and the other churches in town joined in too. Dozens of windows were broken, but they didn't stop. And then further on, the members, and then spreading throughout the community, put either menorahs or pictures of menorahs in their windows. And by the end of that 8-day holiday, it's estimated there were 10,000 menorahs in windows and buildings. Too much for hate to prevail. Soon, billboards started arising, and church signs and business signs, window fronts, "Not in our town." That's the church being salt. It's the church being light. And that's the other image that Jesus brings into this discussion. We're to be light. You know, that's another one that's a little hard for us to understand. Light for us is simply a matter of flicking a switch. We have electricity, but in those days, light was a precious commodity. You know, one of the popular things in real estate today is to talk about open floor plans. You know, where the rooms all flow into each other, there's not many walls, so you can stand in the kitchen and yell at your guests in the family room and the kids running around. You know, people back in Jesus' day would have laughed that people want that because they were stuck with it. You see, their houses were typically one large room. There might have been a corner, an alcove where the family slept, and another one where maybe they gathered, and another one where they cooked and ate, but it was one big room. The lamps to light a house back then were fueled in this region mostly by olive oil, which wasn't cheap back then. It isn't cheap now either. And so most families would maybe prioritize having a lamp 1 or 2 hours a week, 1 or 2 hours a night for a few days a week. They might take that time to have some family time together, even to help the kids with their reading, to do some prayers. And it made no sense, as Jesus points out, to go to the expense and the trouble of having that lamp lit and then covering it with a bushel. Those houses were all built with a table, a pedestal, a lampstand in the middle, so that the lamp could be placed there and light the whole room. And then he goes on to give an allusion that they would have been familiar with, or not so much. An allusion, an image of travelers. Travel back then was hard and risky, dangerous even. Today, you know, we hop in a car, we want to go somewhere, we hop in a car, or we drive on paved interstate roads, or we hop on a plane and we go in 3 hours, what would have taken somebody back then a year to travel. But in those days, travel was risky business. And there were a couple of distinct rules that ruled over travel, over safe travel. Number one is you didn't do it by yourself. And you didn't even do it in a small group. Big groups traveled. We see that if you remember the story of Jesus when he was 12 getting left behind at the temple in Jerusalem. Social services would have been called today, but in those days, Joseph and Mary, the family, was obviously part of a very large group that had traveled from Nazareth to Jerusalem, that 2 to 3 day journey to celebrate the Passover. And they had headed out, and they assumed Jesus was somewhere in that big group until they got about a day's travel away and realized he wasn't. They traveled in big groups for protection because in between those towns it was very desolate. And there were robbers. You know the story of the Good Samaritan, of course. It was dangerous to travel those desolate highways in a small group, or especially by yourself. The Good Samaritan, that person made that mistake, right? So Jesus is using this image of traveling because he talks about you can't hide a city on a hillside. The other rule of traveling is you didn't do it at night. Not only were the robbers around, then you got to deal with animals too. So as the group of travelers is coming along, the sun's beginning to set, the day is beginning to darken, they would look and see a city, find a city where they could spend the evening behind the safety of those walls. And what beckoned them to that town or that village was the light shining. And Jesus says we're to be like that, like light shining that draws people to safety, to hospitality. It's a hard image for us to think. And I'm afraid that so much of that is true because it's not how we act all too often in our churches, is it? You know, Nielsen just did a study of a survey of young folks who were under 30. And they asked them what they thought of the Christian faith. And the response was breathtakingly bad. The vast majority said they rejected it. They said they saw Christians as judgmental, as inhospitable, as arrogant. I think salt and light were mentioned. You know, the interesting thing about that same survey, though, was they asked those folks under 30 what they thought of Jesus, and they liked Jesus. We've got some work to do. We're called to be salt. We're called to be light, not to be whiny complainers about what's going on in our world, not to be arrogant judges of who's doing right and who's doing wrong according to our standards. We're called to attract and welcome and harbor and preserve. It all boils down to this. We're called to be different. Different than the world. And that's a challenge. It's come up several times in Bible study recently. And I asked the question, and I paused too. I don't get immediate shouted responses. How are we to be different? How are we as followers of Christ to be different from the rest of the world? It brings to mind a poster that was hanging in the children's choir room of the first church that I served. And I'll share its message, the message of that poster to you today. It said, if you lived in a world where Christianity was suddenly made illegal and you were brought up on charges of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? I don't know, it's a challenge, but I do know this. We serve a God of grace and love. A God who loves this world enough that he came to us in Christ. A God who loves this world enough that he left behind a church to be salt and light. What a challenge, but what a privilege too. Amen. Let's pray. A loving and gracious God, forgive us, Lord, when we fall short of the call of Christ to love our world as we have been loved, to bring light and life and joy, to bring peace. Empower us, guide us by your Spirit, that we might truly be Christ's church in this place. We ask in his name. Amen. I invite you now, those of you who are who have interest in joining our congregation, I invite you to join me in the center aisle here. We like to do this in the center aisle because as people come to join our congregation, they are symbolically joining in the midst. So I invite those of you who are uniting with our church to come stand with me in the center here, please. Gladys, come on down, Becky, if you can make it. Thanks. Anita? We'll have a chance to greet these folks and enjoy some food and fellowship with them after church as well. Membership, we've talked about what membership is. Membership is uniting with a church and saying, I want to extend my love of Christ, my love for neighbors, through this body. And that's what these folks are doing here today. And so I ask all of you this question. Do you this day profess your faith in Jesus Christ, trust in His grace alone, and wish to join hands and hearts with fellow believers in this church body, the West Alameda Community Baptist Church, working together for the kingdom of heaven and the glory of God? If so, say, I do or not.
I do.
And now I invite all of you to join in the response that is printed on the back page of your bulletin. It would be projected, but it's not. And Patricia and I are going to share. We rejoice to welcome you as members of West Alameda Community Baptist Church and join with you as we together work for God's glorious kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let's give these folks a round of applause as we welcome them. Thank you. You can all watch Gladys, who's the best backer-upper in all of EDC. You know, as we were planning this special day of joining, having new members join with us, it struck me that we have a member who has been with us for a long time. Now, to be honest, the church's early days go back to 1951, and Robbie was a little bit of a slacker. I looked it up, and I don't think Robbie joined our church until 1953. Does that sound about right, Robbie? You were here very early, almost at the very beginning, but I think it was the earliest days. Robbie is our longest term member. And I wanted to honor her because many of you have not been here long enough to know that Robbie was not only a founder of our church, she was truly a founding cornerstone of Eden Senior Communities too. She helped Dean Painter in the design, in the decorating. For years, she took on the task of decorating for Christmas and for holidays, not only in the center, but throughout the whole building. She did table decorations in the dining room. She served, I can't tell you how many years, as church, as moderator and recorder for the church board. She's done so much. And Robbie, I just would love you to stand up if you're able, so folks can see you and offer you a round of thanks for all that you do and have done for us, Robbie. Let's give Robbie a show of appreciation. Immediately after the postlude today, we will go to the, and you'll all be waiting for the elevator anyway, but we're gonna be right out there. The church purchased a leaf on the Tree of Life, and we're dedicating that today to honor Robbie. To show the world that we appreciate all that she has done for our church and for our community. So right after the post-it, I invite you to just go out the doors to the elevator there, and we'll just have a quick dedication and prayer as we thank Robbie for all she does for us. Thank you, Robbie. And now I invite you to remain seated for our closing hymn. Some of you may recall it from Sunday school. This little light of mine, we've got David to really lead us in it. He came here and he said, oh man, I forgot my tambourine. I said, that's okay. Let's remain seated and sing together This Little Light of Mine.
Don't you try to blow it out. I'm gonna let it shine. Don't you try to blow it out.
good. I think about 26th graders could have outsung us on that. But overall, pretty good. I invite you again. Let's dedicate the special leaf we have for Robbie, and then come back. We have a ton of food, so I hope you're able to stay for fellowship brunch following the service. And again, thank you to David and Carl for sharing their musical gifts with us in worship today. We so appreciate it. As we go forward, I invite you to receive these words of blessing and benediction. Loving God, we go forth from this place. We go forth to love and to serve, to let the light that you have given us shine through us. And as we go, Lord, guide our paths and light our footsteps. Give us hearts that we might be true disciples of Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Amen.